Joe. Joe on Joe is the only podcast where Joe talks about Joe. And now, your host, Joe Slepsky.
Hey, Joe on Joe listeners, it's me, Joe Slepsky. And I'm back and you're back. This is the quarantine re-releases of our original tracks going back 4 years. And I hope you're enjoying these as much as I'm enjoying reliving them, warts and all. I think you can easily hear where I'm finding myself and finding what the show turned out to be. So I'm really happy to share these with you guys. Again, we pulled these back from behind the Patreon wall, and I wanted to make them available to everybody during this time to share and give and listen and have fun, especially because G.I. Joe's back on YouTube now. So, yeah, so I appreciate that. And you guys can always follow me at Joe on Joe Pod on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. Let me know what you think some of these early episodes, how terrible they are, or how funny they are, or how awful they are. And we're starting recording back up again, so reach out to me. Let me know, joeonjoepod@gmail.com. Let me know if you want to join me for an episode. I believe we're going to jump into G.I. Joe Extreme very, very soon. So without any further ado, here is the OG track from Joe on Joe 4 years ago. Enjoy.
You are listening to the Joe on Joe podcast, the only podcast where Joe talks about Joe. And now, your host, Joe Slepsky.
Hi, and welcome back to Joe on Joe, the only podcast where I, Joe Slepsky, will review every episode of G.I. Joe, and I am extremely excited this week to have a guest who is a good personal friend of mine. He is a writer.
Just friends?
More than just friends on occasion. He is a writer. He is a comic book expert and historian. Mm-hmm. He is an artist. He is one of the hardest working people that I know. And he is an activist, and you are a man of many things, Mr. Seek Donnelly.
One thing I'm not is an official G.I. Joe member, though.
Well, you will be after this episode.
Yes, that's on my bucket list.
Seek Donnelly. First, let's get a few things out of the way. We can find you on Twitter at Seek and Destroy.
Instagram is Seek and Destroy. On Twitter is Exploding Bullet.
Awesome. Yeah. So Seek, you, you're a writer.
I am.
Based out of L.A., originally from?
Wheeling, West Virginia.
Wheeling, West Virginia. And you work at Lego.
I work at Lego part-time, and I work for a company called OSSM Comics.
It's fantastic. And you're the EIC there?
EIC and marketing director are what's on my business card.
Awesome. And primarily, though, I know you as a super talented writer.
Thanks.
You've written a comic book called Soul Star. Mm-hmm. You've written a comic book called...
Which you drew a page of.
I did draw a page of. I was very honored to be a part of it.
Yeah.
You also did a book called Monomyth.
Mm-hmm.
They're both available via Awesome OSSM Comics. Is it?
You can awesomecomics.com, yep. OSSM, or you can get them on Amazon as well.
Very cool. And you've also finished, I'm not sure if it's been released yet, your Peter Pan story?
This summer. Summer 2016.
And so it's called, and what's it called?
The King of Neverland.
The King of Neverland. Yeah. Little tease as to what it's about?
It's a sequel to Peter Pan, unofficial sequel, but it's kind of Peter Pan becoming the villain of the story. I always think heroes make really good villains. So Peter Pan is the new Captain Hook, if you will.
That's exciting.
Yeah, it's good.
That's very cool. And Seek has, Seek does YouTube videos.
I do have a YouTube channel called Seek and Destroy.
Seek and Destroy.
And you can find it at youtube.com/C/SeekDonnelly.
Awesome. And if you're coming to this episode from there, because this is actually part two of a two-parter. Seek had me on his YouTube channel in order to do an unboxing for an Amazon exclusive G.I. Joe Retaliation 4-pack. And I was so honored.
It was fun.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And so this is the continuation. So if you're just joining us, coming over from Seek's page, thank you so much.
Yes.
And if you've not seen Seek's video, please check it out.
Please do, because we have a toy giveaway that we're doing that Joe added a G.I. Joe comic onto. So if you're a Deadpool fan, definitely check out that video and share this episode we're doing right now with the hashtag Joe on Joe.
Absolutely. Right?
Yep. And if you use that hashtag Joe on Joe or Joe on Joe podcast, I'll look for both of those.
Mm-hmm.
And if you use that hashtag and share this episode like crazy, 3 weeks from the airing of this episode, I will pick a winner on my channel and I'll let Joe know who the winner is so he can tell his viewers as well.
Absolutely. And we'll send you a free Joe comic book and a Deadpool.
Yeah. Deadpool action figure.
It's my first contest for Joe on Joe.
Well, get ready.
Many
more to come.
I'm so excited. So let's get into your history with G.I. Joe. Did you watch it growing up?
I did, actually. We lived in Athens, Greece, and we got like stuff late over there. Because right from Wheeling, I was 1 year old, moved to Athens, and I lived there till I was like six. And over there, we were watching like Wonder Woman and Batman, the TV shows.
Mm-hmm.
When we came back to the States, I had a lot of catching up to do because it was Transformers, it was G.I. Joe. He-Man made it to Greece. But
of course He-Man made it to Greece.
Right. But the other ones didn't. The other shows didn't.
And when He-Man started showing up on Grecian television, they were like, oh, look, a documentary.
Pretty much. Yeah, exactly. He's based off all their statues over there. So when I came over here, G.I. Joe and Transformers were like, every kid was like, why don't you know what these are? You know, because this was like the mid 80s or something. Okay. So every kid I made friends with, they were like, you don't know what G.I. Joe is? You don't know what Transformers is? So that was my introduction. And those precede my love of comics, which I've been reading comics almost my whole life. So G.I. Joe and Transformers were before comics for me.
Yeah. I'm a few years older than you.
Yeah.
But G.I. Joe as a brand, I guess, is absolutely people of our generation's gateway to all this stuff.
Oh, absolutely.
If you're a comic reader, I can't tell you how many times people of our generation goes, oh yeah, I started with G.I. Joe comics.
Right.
Oh yeah, I started with G.I. Joe toys and then I moved into other stuff. G.I. Joe just owned that era. I think Transformers I would say has longer legs.
Right.
And they've stayed high generationally.
Right.
But in He-Man was huge when it started, but it flamed out pretty quickly. G.I. Joe just had that steady, like, and maybe it's the Reaganomics, maybe it's that patriotism that swept America.
Right. It came out at the perfect time.
Exactly.
Right. Like it's a product of its time and it lasted long because of when it came out.
Right.
And I grew up in a military family. So I grew up in the Air Force family and my grandfather was in the Army. So, so G.I. Joe just made sense, you know?
Sure.
And the only reason I like Transformers also is because most of them were soldiers. Technically they were in a war.
Right.
So I like that too.
Did you ever get into the larger scale stuff? We don't get into that much. I'm not a big fan of the 12 inch.
Yeah. 12 inch figures. Original G.I. Joe. I had a couple of them. I did have a couple, actually. When my parents were together, we had a little bit of money, so every once in a while I'd get a toy.
Mm-hmm.
When they split up, though, that's when my toy collecting died down for a few years.
Yeah.
I had a couple of them. I want to say I had a, I know I had Joe.
They did make a Joe. Joe Colton, eventually.
Okay.
But you probably wouldn't have had him when you were a kid. Probably like Duke.
Duke, that's Duke, what I meant.
Yeah,
I meant
yeah,
to say was, Duke.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was going to say Channing Tatum, but I was, yeah, Duke. I didn't have a Channing Tatum. Yeah, right. I had a Magic Mike doll. that was good, though. I had Duke, and I had one other one. It was a bad guy. It was a bad guy. I can't remember. I want to say it was Destro, but only because of the silver head.
It could have been Destro, Cobra Commander.
Yeah, I know it wasn't Cobra Commander. But so I had just two of those, but I mostly like the small ones.
Yeah.
Because they were in scale with my Transformers, which I like the Transformers being bigger than them.
Were you a fan of the G.I. Joe Transformers crossover comic?
Yeah, and that's what, you know, comics, like, I did in my first stack that my mom bought me. I was in the hospital, and she came with a bunch of comics. And in that stack was like Superman, Batman, and, you know, Spider-Man, stuff like that. But the guy she went in the store blind. She's like, I need some stuff for my son. He's not, you know, he's sick and he's in the hospital. He needs some stuff to read. And she knew I liked reading. Like, I was reading books at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And then so she brought a stack of comics. And in that stack, because she knew I liked Transformers and G.I. Joe, there was like one or two of those in there. And they were the Marvel ones.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, wow. So most of that stack was Marvel stuff.
I got my all four issues of G.I. Joe versus Transformers. I distinctly remember this. It was summertime. I don't remember what year, but I was staying in Fort Wayne, Indiana at my cousin's house.
Okay.
And my cousin, I'm the youngest of all the cousins, so he's much older. We piled into his Jeep, which had a hole in the floor, which I found fascinating. You know, I was probably 13 years old.
Right.
And he took me to all the comic shops in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And that's when I first saw G.I. Joe versus Transformers as a thing. I didn't know that was a series.
Sure.
And I was like, oh, I have to get all these. So he took me to every comic shop in the area until we found all four issues of it.
That's pretty awesome.
I still have those issues. Yeah, yeah.
I still nerd out when they cross over because I think recently IDW's launched a series, Transformers vs. G.I. Joe, and John Barber, I think, is doing the art.
Yeah, Tom Scioli.
Yeah. And
I think Barber's writing it, I think.
Is
Barber doing...
You might be right, though, because I know Barber does a lot of the Transformer stuff.
Yeah.
So you're right.
I think
I switched the
either
names.
Either way, it's
pretty good.
Dynamite.
Yeah, I love their stuff.
It's so crazy.
Yeah.
It's so like, okay, these are just action figures having fun.
Right, yeah.
I really enjoy that. I really love the Devil's Due ones they did.
I do. I like those.
Were set in World War II,
mm-hmm.
and you had the Transformers were all like era-specific World War II
vehicles. Stuff. Yeah,
and,
right.
Oh, that was great.
Yeah.
I think Jai Lee...
Yeah, Jay Lee was the artist. Yeah,
he did a lot of the art.
Yeah, it was great.
Artists. Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, like that stuff was awesome.
Yeah.
I think one of them they never finished. I think they came out with like one issue and then they lost the they had the license.
Yeah, there was a licensing issue.
So there's one like
with
unfinished
that.
Version of it because they did at least three.
It was a mini series, and they didn't. I don't think they finished it.
All right. Well, any favorite toys, real quick? Any Joe
of Joe's?
Yeah, any Joe favorite toys?
Because I can't really remember a lot of the ones I had as a kid. I had a bunch of them, but I probably had more He-Mans and Transformers.
Mm-hmm.
I will say as an adult, though, recently, like we did in the toy video, I've been buying a lot of the 50th anniversary Hasbro ones that came out recently. Because a lot of those are making their way to clearance racks at Toys R Us's. And I'm usually broke, but I love Hasbro stuff. And I'm a big fan of their toys. So when I saw those available... I've been buying those. So I would say the 4-pack we just did, I'm happy to have that. Mm-hmm. And then I got Hawk and Shipwreck and Cobra Commander.
I love Shipwreck.
And Shipwreck comes with like his parrot and everything.
Holly.
Yeah, and the figures are insanely amazing. So I have the nostalgic love for the figures, and you brought a couple over in my video that we did. But I would say I'm really happy I got some of the new stuff too.
That's great. Well, I'm so excited. We're going to watch, this is the second episode of the regular series. So there were three miniseries.
Mm-hmm.
The first was in 1983,
mm-hmm.
the fall of 83. Then the second miniseries was fall of 84.
Right.
So put your mind, this is now the fall. This probably would have been like second or third week of October, mm-hmm. 1985. So
okay.
I was 10 years old. How old would you?
Oh man,
you've been like four.
I was three or four. My brother was just born.
Yeah,
yeah.
So this is like October 1985, mm-hmm. and it's this, and you're getting an ongoing series. So this probably would have aired on a Tuesday.
Yeah, okay.
Because it was 5 days a week.
Yep.
And it's called Red Rocket's Glare.
Sweet.
Let's get into it.
Let's do it, bro.
Joe, indeed. So, did you used to get a kick out of the opening like I did?
Oh, the opening, the song is embedded in my brain even through an aneurysm.
Yeah. Like yeah, that says a lot.
That's how you know you got a good song. I think I remembered this in the Beatles. That was pretty much...
I always appreciated that in later years, I recognize it as the money they put behind it, but
sure.
But just that the opening looked so sharp, and it really set a nice precedent, you know?
Yeah, well, like, it sets the tone.
Yeah, sets the tone,
you know,
right.
Of what the overall show's going
to
be.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if we haven't gotten to the movie yet, or, you know, we'll get to that eventually, but the opening credit for the movie is dynamite.
I remember the movie.
So well done. It's all the fighter on the Statue
of
Liberty.
Right. Oh, that's
wow.
Right. Yeah.
So Red Rocket's Glare, written by Mary Screens.
Yep.
Ooh, this is the second episode now in a row written by a woman.
Nice.
Yeah. And Ron Friedman wrote all the miniseries. So technically there have been three Joe writers so far, and two of them are women.
That's pretty progressive of them. Nice.
So we open on it's a jungle. Probably some South American jungle, and there's a young South American lad who's running through the jungle, and Rakondo and Roadblock show up. We don't know if they're pursuing him or exactly what they're doing, and behind them is the most inappropriately dressed G.I. Joe for the jungle action in Barbecue.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's got orange and yellow on.
No, I'm sorry. Wait, no, that's I'm sorry. Blowtorch. I'm wrong. That's blowtorch. Blowtorch. I was just going to say, it's not barbecue. Yeah. Barbecue put out the fires. Blowtorch started the fires.
I'm glad Roadblock is me. I would be sweating like that.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
In the movie, The Rock was sweating a lot too.
Oh, The Rock was just oiled up.
Well, okay. Rock maybe
just
that's
oils
it.
Himself up. I don't know if you call muscle butters.
He's got pit like sweat stains though. I mean,
does he?
Yeah. Oh yeah. He's sweaty in those movies.
He's too busy smelling what he's cooking. So this South American kid, he delivers something to Destro. So basically, it's another South American jungle. Base for
yeah,
COVID.
They have like a Mayan temple that they're right. hanging out in,
and there's a huge ravine that they're gonna that the Joes are about to cross, and Ricardo and Blowtorch and Roadblock they bring the bridge layer.
Up. Yeah, this toy was ridiculous.
Yeah, this toy is so silly. It got so much mileage on the show. They use it a ton on this.
Well, they. I mean, look how convenient. It's a great plot like totally. Device.
Yeah. And they blow the three of them. I guess with Tollbooth involved, four of them. Mm-hmm. They blow this. They blow into the temple. Destro's upset because he's almost done with his experiments. You don't know what the experiments are.
Right.
Now, Blowtorch actually talks with this thick Irish brogue, which later would be actually be attributed to barbecue. Which is, I think, why I'm getting it confused.
Okay, because I was wondering if he was Irish. He sounds
yeah,
Irish.
Yeah, well, I mean, he is. Okay. It looks like he is, but which is that stereotype Irish fireman. Like,
of
only
course.
Irishmen have
right.
to be firemen or right. boxers. That's right. all they can be.
Yeah.
But later on, Barbecue, who is the fireman, he really has an Irish accent.
Right.
And I think it's a misapplied accent here.
Does he catch on fire here? It looks like he does, and then he's fine.
He does, and he is fine, because his suit's insulated.
The suit's
his
insulated.
Suit's insulated
okay.
against fire, which is also really, why are you wearing that suit in the jungle? That is going to be sweaty. So
yeah.
Blowtorch busts in. He blows up the lab. But Destro escapes with a nice sliding door.
Right. That's why he's so thin. He's just sweating.
He's just thin. He's a rail thin.
Let's see how Blowtorch is making out.
There's the kid now. So Blowtorch got ahead of all these guys to get in there by himself.
And he's upset. Now, I'm going to bring this up now to not spoil the rest of the episode. But
he was carrying something.
You have this opening where it features Blowtorch, and it's, you know, he has this moment of like, yeah, you're a rookie. You'll be okay, kid.
Right.
And then he disappears from the show.
I noticed that too. Like, and that happens a lot in G.I. Joe where these plot threads that are set up just don't pay off.
Right.
Like, they're just like, yeah.
Yeah. In the previous episode, they did it well where they had introduced some Cobra recruits, actually. And the
right.
Cobra recruits were getting trained by the Dreadnoughts. And then they brought them full circle. They brought them to the final battle and they got them involved in the action.
Sure.
And that's the last we see a Blowtorch for this whole episode.
Yeah.
So Destro now meets up with the Crimson Twins and Cobra Commander in one of the coolest shots, animation
that
shots.
That silhouette shot was amazing.
Yeah. It's a stone white room with the four guys in shadowy silhouette.
Mm-hmm.
It looks just gorgeous.
It's pretty dope.
Yeah. I'm
very
all for
artistic
that.
For, yeah.
Yeah, it really is. It's,
yeah.
It's a nice.
Like if you saw that print at a show, it would be like a Mondo print and people would swarm to it.
It totally would. If
right?
They, if Mondo did an album of the G.I. Joe music.
That shot right there.
Absolutely would be that
I
shot.
I like it.
So we've got Roadblock and Ricardo. They're now on vacation, and they're going to stop at like a Red Rocket burger stand, which is basically McDonald's meets Red Robin. You know,
pretty
and it's,
much.
It's a burger stand with a giant Red Rocket literally on top of the drive-in. And Roadblock says, "We're not going to eat there because that food's crap. We're going to go to my aunt and uncle's."
Are you sure it's not a Red Rocket or a Red Robin and a Johnny Rockets?
You probably more appropriate. It's like Johnny Rockets ate Red Robin.
There you go.
And so they go to Roblox aunt and uncle's restaurant, and it's also a Red Rocket place, which disappoints them.
Right.
And they say hi, and they love seeing him, and they're calling him Marvin.
Marvin, it's so good to see you.
Call me Roblox.
Yeah, and his friend.
Embarrassing.
Notices. Yeah, right.
So the snicker nape Ricardo,
the Joe's jungle trooper, he can find the eyelash you lost in the woods 2 years ago.
That's the best line.
That's the best line ever.
Here's a summary of his powers. He can find your eyelash that you lost in the jungle 2 years ago.
That's what Ricardo can do
that's
for you.
That's Ricardo's powers.
Yeah. And of course, Marvin is Marvin Hinton.
Right.
And he is a good chef. He likes to rhyme.
Mm-hmm.
He's absolutely, absolutely, easily one of the top five Joes.
Roadblock is cool.
Roadblock's so cool.
I like him.
Yeah.
He was the one I remembered when they cast. They were like, oh, The Rock's playing him. I'm like, oh, I know Roadblock.
Yeah,
cool.
Now, they lost copyright to Roadblock for a few years.
There was something
strange went on with the Roadblock character, and I apologize for not doing the research. I've actually never been able to get the full answer myself when I've looked into it. That's why they didn't use Roadblock in the first movie. It was supposed to be a Roadblock, but they used Heavy Duty, and they said Heavy Duty was his cousin. Heavy Duty is his cousin, line. But they couldn't use Roadblock initially because there was some lawsuit or some live action.
Transformers has it too with a lot of, like, you can't call Rodim, you have to call him Rodimus, not Hot Rod anymore.
Oh, really?
So there's like weird things like that. It's because the license for the toys and license for the show were made at different times or something.
Yeah,
that's weird.
So I'm glad they sorted it out, because I love seeing The Rock. I like The Rock.
Anyway. I like The Rock a lot.
Yeah.
I love this part here, like with them, because it's like they're in there and they're talking to his family, and then these kids show up, and he's like, oh, these are the kids giving you trouble? We'll go kick their butt. And then he's like, his uncle's like, no, it's not them. It's those guys on the motorcycles with laser guns. Yeah. and then these badasses show up, and they have to fight them.
Yeah.
And they chase them away.
It's pretty great. Yeah. It's like Happy Days meets Road Warrior.
Yeah, it's pretty great.
So they chase the guys away, and now we see the Crimson Twins flying over Extensive Enterprises. And they jump from a moving airplane with no parachute.
Nope.
Do a couple flips and land on the roof of their skyscraper.
The best part about that is they kick the door open, the hatch open, and no one gets sucked out. There's like a plane full of people.
No one gets sucked out. Well, I would say it's probably their private plane.
Okay.
So it's probably not a plane full of people, but the door just flies off.
That's true.
But
they do show a couple people in there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
there's at least stewardesses. Okay. The door flies right off. There's no like opening the door, like it slides. No. It just falls on the street.
Yeah.
And then they jump from a moving airplane with no parachute.
And land on a building.
And land on top of the building. It does show they're acrobats, though.
They did flip nicely.
Yeah. So it turns out that they are trying to buy up all the Red Rocket hamburger joints all over the country. And it's being led by a creepy, greasy lawyer type. Mm-hmm. Mr. Krieg.
Right.
So they give him instructions to go to a specific location, which is the one that's, of course, owned by Roadblock. You got the extreme measures there.
So yeah, they have this scheme, and they're replacing the rocket tips of all the Red Rocket signs
with a flashing nose cone.
With an actual warhead.
And now we go to break. Joel will return after these
messages. Today's file card feature is Tollbooth, the bridge layer driver. His file name is Chuck Gorin. Technically, his middle name is X, which stands for nothing. And his primary military specialty is the combat engineer, and his secondary specialty is demolitions. His birthplace is Boise, Idaho. He's a grade SP5. A toll booth's parents gave him a construction set for Christmas when he was 6. He wore it out by the time he was 7. Every Christmas, his sets got bigger and more complex until he was too old to play with toys anymore. Then he started building in earnest. He got his master's in engineering from MIT and joined the Army expressly to sign up for the G.I. Joe team. He needed that challenge as he had all his life. Stalker says, "We're on our way to an objective and we come across an obstacle we can't cross. River, crevasse, mountain, whatever. Tollbooth gets us across. He may build a bridge out of whatever's there, blast a pass through solid rock, lay down a four-lane blacktop. That man's got magic." A tollbooth was the bridge layer driver. And I do tollbooth this early because in these early episodes, the bridge layer is everywhere. They're always running into a crevasse or a ravine or a mountainside. And all of a sudden, here comes the bridge layer. It just looks so dumb. But it's so useful. But it's so dumb. Like, they were pushing that toy really hard. But I gotta love it. I gotta respect you, Chuck X. Gorin. Here's to Tollbooth. We salute you. I'll take your heart.
Now back to G.I. Joe.
and those warheads that are flashing Seek, of course.
Oh, yeah. Those were part of Destro's plan at the beginning, right? What he was setting up. Okay.
So it's all starting to come together for the viewer of what exactly, why does Cobra care so much about fast food?
Right. Well, I mean, I just thought they were burger fans like me.
Burger fans, or they were just slowly trying to kill us. Right. By introducing fast food. I mean, that's the more insidious plan, really.
Yeah.
Cobra's going to take over the world by making us all fat and lazy to fight.
That would have been a better plan.
Totally. And the family that's in this window, if anyone's fans of the Power Pack cartoon, look just like the family from Power Pack.
A little bit.
It looks like the Power family, which also, by the way, were modeled after Walter and Louise Simonson. So Walter and Louise Simonson just made a cameo in G.I. Joe.
Nice.
I'm going to throw that out there.
Nice.
And the Joes, so Roadblock called for backup.
Lady Joe, Flint, and Cutter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they pulled up in a killer whale.
Yeah, hovercraft.
Hovercraft.
Yeah. Came right off the beach into the parking lot.
Yeah. Very convenient.
and then Mr. Quib?
Quint? Quinn? Quig?
Yeah.
Quig.
Quig is now here in Roadblock's
and
throwing
Roadblock
his
butt. Just gives him the heave ho.
Yeah. It's like, we're not selling. And you're not buying. You wanna make nice. Clear.
That's so great. Throws his briefcase after him. And so now Mr. Quig, he gives the signal to probably the least effective Vipers of all time. The Televipers were terrible. The only cool thing about the asps start firing down on the burger place, and there's a serious explosion.
Did Walt and Louise just die?
Walt and Louise just died. Like, oh my God. This is also, you know what, this whole scheme, it's a precursor to the Breaking Bad El Pollo Loco or El Pollo Compadre.
It's a pretty good shootout, but my problem here is that they don't shoot the Joe's vehicle right away.
They? No,
right.
Why would they?
That's the thing you need to take out.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it can go up mountains and get them.
Yep, apparently the hovercraft can go straight up the side of a really steep mountain.
Now, I know who the regular Cobra henchmen are.
Uh-huh.
But there's a guy dressed as Paladin from Spider-Man from the 90s. Who's
really?
That?
Really? Yeah. That guy. See, he's a Televiper.
He's a Televiper.
And,
oh, he's
and they're the communication
about.
Vipers.
Gotcha.
But let me say this to you.
Yeah.
There's a crew of Televipers. How many communication Vipers do you need? Like, I would send in a straight-up cadre of Vipers.
Right.
And, like, one telecommunication Viper.
Yeah, at least one.
The cool thing they did start doing with them is... the messages they would send would start, they don't do it in this episode, but they start showing up in reverse on their eye, their goggles.
Okay.
So it's like they're seeing it on the inside of their goggle. They're seeing it cut across normally, like, you know, retreat, evacuate, or whatever.
Sure.
It would flash across their eyes,
okay.
But it would go backwards because implying that they're seeing it on the inside of their goggles.
Right. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, so, I mean, they do something cool, but to have just a whole cadre of Televipers leading this assault... I feel like that's not a winning combination.
No, it's not good. So what happened was after the attack on the Red Rocket, they chased Cobra away.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're back at their headquarters?
Back at the headquarters now. And Breaker is...
Snake Eyes.
Yeah, there we got a nice appearance by Snake Eyes. And I love... Snake Eyes is great because you could just cameo him in the background.
Yeah.
He does not going to say anything.
Well, no, why would he?
Yeah, right. So you could just always have cameo Snake. Snake Eyes never has any downtime. Because he just cameos everywhere.
Yeah.
They don't have to worry about giving him dialogue. You don't have to say, why is that one Joe not saying? No, it's just Snake Eyes. He's cool.
Sure.
He's cool. He's chilling.
Well, yeah, he just makes a fist like, let's go kick their butts.
Punch some people. Punch some people.
But I like that part because it's like they show a map of the U.S. because Cobra has released, hey, this is the places we're going to be attacking you guys at.
Right.
And Roadblock instantly goes, hey, that's where all the Red Rockets are.
We're coming to that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
gotcha.
Yeah, we're coming to that. We're gonna get
well,
that.
He just showed the map and he was
they haven't figured it out yet.
Oh, he hasn't figured it out.
They haven't figured it out yet.
Okay.
But Roadblock and Jay and Flint, they come to see... they come to pay attention to Tomax and Zaymot, and they kind of threaten them down.
Yeah.
And I will say this.
Cobra can, at times, be a bit heavy-handed, but we can't be held responsible for every action of our business associates. We recommend you take it up with Cobra.
Okay, it's obvious we're not going to get any cooperation here.
it's like, all right, we're done.
Well, I like that they can walk into a business of a terrorist organization.
Yeah.
On a Tuesday. Yeah. And then be like, we don't like what you're doing. They're like, we can't be responsible. Yeah. He's like, all right, have a good day.
Well, it's that Lex Luthor move. It's a diplomat. Yeah, he's always man, Luther, I know you're behind this. And he's like, yeah, you can't touch me because Extensive Enterprises, they're a legit, quote unquote, legitimate company.
That's true.
They front Cobra, but the Joes can never prove it.
Right, right. Okay.
So that's the deal with them. And the same thing with Destro. He's an arms dealer.
Right.
That deals arms to Cobra.
Right.
But he also sells arms to other people, too.
Right, okay. He's a free agent.
Right, he's a free agent, right, which technically, sorry. And Tomex and Zaymont are supposed to, if you go by the file card stuff, they don't do it, really don't deal with it much in the show. They're Italian, and they're supposed to be like the mafia.
Oh, okay.
They're supposed to represent that arm of the mafia, which is like legitimate businessmen. You know, they probably do a lot of olive oil importing.
Sure.
So,
well, Lady J just broke into their office.
Lady
and
J broke
their
into
butt.
Their offices, and they're doing a bunch of kung fu. And they dive out the window. She grabs onto the leg of the dragonfly helicopter, and they grab onto her, and they are now plummeting 1,000 feet to the ground. And we go to the break.
G.I. Joe will return after these messages. Now, back to G.I. Joe.
Lady J, Tomax, and Zaymont are falling to their deaths from the top of a 60-floor skyscraper.
Yeah.
And Lady J throws a big old dagger, or one of her spears.
It's a spear with a rope on it, which she didn't have a few seconds ago.
She has it in her quiver. She's like Hawkeye and Green Arrow.
But you can always see their quiver.
But she didn't have a quiver?
No.
Well, here's what's great. So Tomek Zaymont hit a few buttons, and a bunch of rods poke out the building that they then like swing like gymnasts, which is cool.
Yeah.
But that implies they were all ready to jump out of their building. Like, that means they had forethought and said, hey, what if we ever took a swan dive off the top of our building? What if we installed some, like, parallel bars to swing off of? Okay, that sounds great.
Redirect our momentum.
Yeah, that sounds like a great idea.
It's a good idea, because I bet you now was the first time they got to use them, and they were like, finally, we got to put those.
I told you it was worth the budget. Yeah, absolutely. So Cobra Commander, he's on American TV right now, and he's showing the map of all their locations, of all the cities that are going to get destroyed.
Right.
And he's broadcasting this to America. They show a demonstration in a quote, exact replica of one of our cities, which also is fantastic because it makes me think, who's building these exact replicas?
What a waste of money.
What a waste of money. Why would you have to do an exact replica of a city? Wouldn't you just straight up blow up a city? Or be like, here, we found a small city no one cares about.
Right.
And they show one podunk dude.
Or a big city everyone cares about.
But now the explosion goes, off and everything's wiped out except... Right. The trees, the grass, and the butterfly.
Right, right.
So this apparently just affects matter, like man-made matter.
Man-made
or something.
Matter, yeah. Yeah, like, yeah. It's a weapon from heaven.
Yeah, and and Flint and Lady J originally noticed that this was being aired because they were pulling, remember that movie Blue Thunder?
Right.
You remember when Blue Thunder would fly through the city and spy on people?
Right.
They just had a Blue Thunder moment.
They totally did. They were peeping in on some girl watching TV.
Totally. Which in the deleted scene of this is that girl turns off the TV and starts, you know, fooling around.
Right.
Roadblock definitely notices what Seek said earlier.
Yeah, that's right. I was remembering that. Yeah. So Roadblock saw the map that Cobra Commander put out there and saying, this is where we're going to launch warheads from. Mm-hmm. And he's like, hey, that's weird. That looks like the map of where all the red rockets are.
Yep.
Yeah.
So they mobilize and they send out the APCs and they send out the Maulers.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got the Skyhawks and Dragonflies and the Sky Strikers and everything G.I. Joe has. They have to go out. I think they said it was around 150 locations across the country. So this is where we get into the physics of G.I. Joe again. One of the things is that they travel wild distances
in a matter of moments. Yeah, they do.
There was it was an episode a few back where they were literally fighting in the Arctic. They jumped on a his tank, which is a treaded tank vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
That tank then took them to a jungle. So G.I. Joe's doing the same thing here. You know, they're rolling out and they're mobilizing and they're going all over the country. And in a very terrifying moment, Cutter just destroyed a Red Rocket location at a seaside carnival.
Like down at the Santa Monica Pier.
There's there's customers in there. There's tourists just getting a burger.
Well, they yell a warning out before they go in. He's like, you got 5 seconds, Cobra, to get out of there. Yeah. I'm like, so does mom and dad just eat their burger?
And listen, I've been in buildings where there have been actual fire drills. Right. It takes me 10 seconds to just go, is that real?
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's just say Cutter just killed some people, but I'm cool with that.
Right.
Hey, better to kill a few than to save a couple.
You gotta
crack
a few eggs,
right? Crack a few eggs. So they're slowly all over the country, the G.I. Joes are they're disabling the red rockets.
Right.
Roadblock just did a sweet maneuver where he jumped off one of the Vamp motorcycles, and now he's straddling a rocket, climbing towards the top to take the nose cone off.
He sure is, and he's got twins with him.
Yeah, exactly.
The Crimson Twins.
The Crimson Twins follow him. And I would say, objectively, this is now where the show gets a little cartoony. For me, this is the moment.
Okay.
From here on out to the rest of the episode.
All right,
fair enough. The other stuff are like physics, like suspension of disbelief stuff.
Okay, right? Fair enough.
This is now, you got Roadblock and the Twins holding on to a rocket as it's flying through the air, and Roadblock's trying to get to the front of the cone.
And they don't care. They're ready to die.
Yeah, apparently the twins are suicidal.
What are you gonna do?
If I could blow the nose cone off that rocket, there's a chance. Maybe. Hang in
there. So now Flint is going to shoot the nose cone off, not with machine guns, with the missile.
He's just going to bump into it.
And the missile literally physically knocks the nose cone off the rocket.
And without either exploding right away.
The missile doesn't explode. The rocket doesn't explode. And then the rocket careens off course and happens to land into a river
that is not established in any previous shot.
No establishing shot for it. So that's where I get a little
I don't know why. Seemed really realistic to me.
Like, for real?
Yeah.
Like, that's a little too far. That's a bridge too far. Bridge layer too far.
It's one bridge layer too far.
So now we wrap up the show. The rest of the Joes, they're all at his aunt and uncle's, and they're having some barbecue. And which is great, because Roblox was always a chef, so I love that they're doing this.
Yeah.
But you see, we don't go back to barbecue or to Blowtorch.
No.
There's no follow-up on that. Which is a little... Because they've renamed the restaurant the Joe's Place.
Right.
It's so good. So see, that's it. So that's the episode. What'd you think?
I mean, I would have liked to seen, obviously, like, if they would have just had one little moment of Blowtorch in there at the end, dismantling one of those bombs and like doing it right and being like, hey, I redeemed myself.
I did it.
Yeah, right. But other than that, I mean, yeah, it's goofy. It's not as serious as I remember it being, because I guess when I was a kid, I fictionalized it really well. But no, overall, it's fun. You're right. That last moment was a little much for me.
A little bridge too far.
But it was fun revisiting it for sure.
That's great. Thank you so much, Seek Donnelly.
Thanks for having me.
And now you, Joe, and Joeing is half the battle.